An article in the December 20th, 1954 issue of Life magazine entitled Uncle Sambo, Mad for Mambo, clearly shows that everyone was doing the Mambo during the 1950s. Here, for example, are just a few of the albums that were cut that year. Papa Loves Mambo, Mambo Italiano, I Saw Mama Doing the Mambo, the St. Louis Blues Mambo, and Loop the Loop Mambo. The Mambo craze was an explosion that lasted over a decade, and the center of that explosion was right here, in the corner of 53rd and Broadway, where, during the golden age of Mambo, stood the legendary Palladium Ballroom.
Right there, 53rd. You won't recognize it now because it's a garage. And they got a big empty building up there. The home of the Mambo, the Palladium. Yeah, baby, you were there? You got married there, I know you.
I mean, we used to get all the Hollywood stars used to go out there, all the big politicians, all the racketeers, all the number players, everybody should go up there. And just you sit down and listen to the music was great and watch the dances. It was a show in itself.
It was a form of foreplay, and you could see it, and that's why people like Marlon Brando, Kim Novak, Shelley Winters, Sammy Davis, they would be there because they'd like to see something like that happen right in front of them.
There was a bar underneath the Palladium that they always thought was going to fall down. You know, people that would sit in the bar because people would be banging their feet so hard and so forth.
The policy usually was to have three or four top name Latin bands a night. And they would just rotate. They'd each do a half hour on and a half hour off, and they just keep rotating bands. And this was the attraction that people wanted to come down, not only to dance, but to talk to the band leaders. And there were more onlookers than there were dancers. When the real dancers got on the floor, everybody just circled around and watched, or stood at the bandstand while Tito Puente or Tito Rodriguez or Machito would play a band number, and just stand there in adulation.
The goal of every musician was to work the Palladium. You know, when I worked it, boy, did I feel great. And guess who I worked it opposite? Tito Puente, you know? So that was a real thrill of my life, you know?
I was there about 14 years, and there were no ethnic groups in them days. There used to get black, white, Chinese, Japanese, Germans, everybody used to go there.
Up to the time of the Palladium, Latins would, by and large, stay in their own uptown dance halls. However, Machito changed all that. Under the direction of Mario Bauza, Machito's band opened new musical avenues by creating Afro-Cuban jazz and by modeling itself after the big American jazz bands of the 30s and 40s. Just as important, Machito and Bauza also opened new business avenues for themselves and Latin groups to come by being the first to bring Latin music and Latin audiences to Midtown Manhattan, and thus paving the way for the Mambo phenomenon that would shortly emerge at the Palladium. Bauza remembers.
I said, why don't we try something? I see where all those Jewish people, they don't come on Sunday. They're with the family or they go somewhere else. And why don't you run one Sunday here for the Latin people? It's no play downtown where they can, more room where they can dance. He said, the idea is good, Mario, but we're afraid. I said, afraid of what? He said, the Mitchell races.
But once the New York impresarios realized just how lucrative the idea would actually be, all other considerations evaporated.
They understand the first dance, they gave away little carts called the Subway Dance up in Harlem. It was given out by the subways all over. The people brought that down. I think they got like a 15-cent discount.
So organize the first Sunday matinee dance, Palladium Ballroom. They opened the door about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. The music started around 5. Before the music started, they had to close the door. And the Broadway was, they closed from 53rd to 55th, they closed Broadway. When I got there, I got scared. I started running, going back to my house. I said, something had happened here. I couldn't believe what I was.
I understand that there was a line around the block, and they thought that the riot was going to ensue there when they saw all these swarthy-looking people there.
After Machito's success at the Palladium, just about every Mambo band leader of distinction followed in his footsteps. One of the first was the great pianist and personality, Noro Morales. Also from Cuba came the irrepressible popular hero, Benny Moré. the versatile and sophisticated Joe Curbelo and Miguelito Babalu Valdez. From Puerto Rico came the melodic crooner and Casanova, Tito Rodriguez. And from East Harlem, the freewheeling future Boogaloo King, Joe Cuba, crazy Joe Loco, and of course, the legendary reigning champion, Tito Puente, to name just a few. Each of these performers owed a great deal to Machito, not only for opening the Palladium to them, but also for providing them with musical inspiration ever since his 1940 hit single, Sopa de Pichón, Pigeon Soup.
Tiene que tomar una sopa de pichón. Lleva. Una sopa de pichón que está bien regordón. Ahí.
Deja Machito que diga lo suyo ahora. ¿Cómo lo decía?
Ahí viene Machito a decir lo que él dice.
Well, when you look at the bands, primarily that were very popular in the 1940s, you have to put up right on the top is Machito and his Afro-Cubans, a band that, to me, is not so much of a band, is a musical institution from which dozens of arrangers, musicians passed through. It influenced so many people, and what it was doing in the 1940s was really revolutionizing Latin music. Under the work that Mario Bauza did with the band.
Buying for Machito's unofficial title as King of the Palladium Mambo were two relative newcomers who had once played together in Joe Curbelo's orchestra, but who now, with bands of their own, had become intense competitors, to say the least. The heated rivalry between Tito Puente and Tito Rodriguez became known to many as the Battle of the Titos.
As far as the music is concerned, I think it really help the music, because they were all both out to outdo each other musically, so they were both looking for really high charge, exciting arrangements, exciting solos, percussion solos, trumpet solos, anything to excite the people, so it made for better music.
He won a top billing, that's all. His name above mine, he can't do it. That was the only competition, no problem. Personally, he was my friend. We used to hang out. But he had a hit record in some recording company there, whatever, major company. Made a lot of noise. So he thought he should be bigger, but that's not it. He had a good band, though. But I had a better band. See, I can say that now, because he's not here to defend himself.
I was always in between the two of them, you know. Mm-hmm. I was the referee.
They would say, oh, do you know that Wednesday night the two Titos are together? That's going to be good, you know, and things like that.
They didn't play any stalling music, let's put it that way, because all bands tend to get a stalling number, you know, they're stalling for time. Not when they were both playing the same night. No way. Only dance music.